वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला आई एम प्रोफेसर वी वेंकटरमण रेड्डी डायरेक्टर ओरिएंटल रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट इन दिस पेपर वी डेल्ट विद द वैदिक एपिक एंड पौराणिक कल्चर ऑफ इंडिया इन दिस मॉड्यूल वी डेल्ट ग्लोरी ऑफ वेदव्यास एंड महाभारत महाभारत इज वन ऑफ द मॉन्यूमेंटल टेक्स्ट ऑफ इंडिया एंड ऑल्सो महाभारत इज कॉल्ड द पंचम वेद इन इंडिया महाभारत इज द basis for development of entire Indian literature, philosophy and also everything in India. The writer of Mahabharata, Vedavyasa is called Maharshi and also he is known as the avatar and also incarnation of Lord Vishnu. Vyaso Narayana Swayam iti one of the famous slokas is Vyasa Maharshi is the incarnation of Narayana. नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं चैव ततो जयमुदीरयेत् इट इज द फर्स्ट बिगिनिंग श्लोक ऑफ महाभारत रेंडर्ड विद द इनकार्नेशन ऑफ वेदव्यास नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न द लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्ट्स ऑफ दिस सिलेबस इंट्रोडक्शन टू द ग्लोरी ऑफ वेदव्यास एंड महाभारत मीनिंग ऑफ व्यास टाइटल व्यास महर्षि ए लिविंग लेजेंड Birth and life of Sage Vyasa, great works of Vedavyasa Maharshi, Vedavyasa, the author of the Mahabharata, evolution of Mahabharata epic, glory of Mahabharata, the summary. The introduction to glory of Vedavyasa and Mahabharata. In India, we celebrate a festival called Guru Purnima with great reverence. Guru plays the vital role in the Indian society and also in the education system. Guru plays the very important role. Without Guru molds the teacher, Guru molds the students, Guru molds the entire society in a normal form. That's why we called Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwarah, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. That is the importance of Guru in the Indian society. It is dedicated to the Vedavyasa Maharshi and it is also known as Vyasa Purnima. We celebrate the Vyasa Purnima day as the birthday of the Vedavyasa. Vedavyasa plays the very important role in the field of education. That's why we call the Guru Purnima as the birthday of the Vedavyasa Maharshi. The day is believed to be his birthday and also the day he divided the Vedas. Every guru who preaches is considered to be representative of Vyasa Maharshi. In every learning center, there will be a Vyasapitam to respect him. That is the glory of Vedavyasa. And also, Vedavyasa plays a vital role in the Indian philosophical system also. Vyasa wrote the Brahma Sutras. Brahma Sutras in the place of Prasthanatrayas. Prasthanatrayas plays a very important role in the Indian philosophy. Meaning of Vedavyasa title. It is very relevant to know the actual meaning of Vyasa. If a circle is drawn and divided into two halves, though a line connecting the center point and the circumferences, this line is called Ardhavyasa. Vyasa represents the whole. So, Ardhavyasa represents the straight line which touches those points. Similarly, Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi touched all the glories of Supreme Personality of God, who is the center of existence and also brought these glories to everywhere. Vyasa Maharshi is a living legend. Maharshi Vedavyasa is considered as Chiranjeevi. Chiranjeevi means a eternal being. In one of the important slokas is told, Prahlada Narada Parasara Pundarika Vyasambariksha Sukha Saunaka Saunakadi. This sloka indicates that these are the Chiranjeevis and also these are the eternal people who loves, lives everywhere in the world and also in human beings. It is said that the appeared and given దర్శన్ టు శ్రీ జగద్గురు శంకరాచార్య అండ్ బ్లెస్ హిమ్ ఫర్ ద బ్రహ్మసూత్ర భాష్యం అండ్ అదర్ వర్క్స్ అండ్ దట్ హీ అపియర్డ్ టు మెనీ అదర్ యాజ్ వెల్ దిస్ ఇట్ ఈస్ బిలీవ్డ్ దట్ సేజ్ వ్యాస లివ్స్ ఫర్ ద వెల్ఫేర్ ఆఫ్ ద హోల్ వరల్డ్ వన్ కెనాట్ ఆబ్వియస్లీ డిస్మిస్ వ్యాస సింప్లీ యాజ్ మోడర్న్ హిస్టోరియన్స్ హ్యావ్ డాన్ యాజ్ ఏ fictional character or at least a writer of fiction with his Mahabharata at best a historical novel. It is said that there have been 28 Vyasas before the present Vedavyasa Krishna Dvaipayana who took his birth as at the seat of Dwapara Yuga. Birth and life of Sage Vyasa. It is the birth and life of Vyasa is a unique in the Indian the mythological stories Vyasa's birth is unique in the place of Maharshis. Krishna Dvaipayana was born of a Parasara Rishi through the Matsyagandhi Satyavati Devi under some peculiar and wonderful circumstances. He was born on an island in the river Yamuna. He was dark complexed. Dark means in the Sanskrit Krishna means a dark. That's why we called Krishna. Dvaipayana means it is a island. Vyasa born in the field Krishna Dvaipayana. That is why his name also called as Krishna Dvaipayana. Hence was named as Krishna Dvaipayana and also the name Dvaipayana meaning island born. Hence the full name of Maharshi is Krishna Dvaipayana. His mother later married the king of Hastinapura, Shantanu and had two sons Vichitravirya. Both sons died issueless and hence their mother asked Vyasa to bless the wives of them with a child. Birth and life of Sage Vyasa. Vyasa fathers the princess Dhritarashtra and Pandu by Ambika and Ambalika. Vyasa told them that they should come alone near him. First did Ambika, but because of shyness and fear, she closed her eyes. It is one of the mythological story narrated in Mahabharata. The birth of Dhritarashtra and Pandu was in the wonderful circumstances in the uniqueness. Vyasa told Satyavati that this child would be blind. Later, this child was named Dhritarashtra. Thus, Satyavati sent Ambalika and warned her that she should remain calm. But Ambalika's face became pale because of fear. Vyasa told her that the child would suffer from anemia and he would not be fit enough to rule the kingdom. Later, this child was known as Pandu. Then Vyasa told Satyavati to send one of them again so that a healthy children can be born. This time, Ambika and Ambalika sent a maid in the place of themselves. The maid was quite calm and composed and she got a healthy child later named as Vidura. Vidura Niti is one of the important story in Mahabharata. In the field of law and also context of dharma, Vidura plays a vital role in Mahabharata. He is the advisor of entire Kuru and Dhritarashtra family also. While these are his sons, another son, Sukha, born of his wife Sage Jabali, daughter Pinjala, is considered his true spiritual heir. Vyasa is supposed to have meditated and authored the epic by the foothills of the river Bias, the Vipas in the Punjab region. There is an ashram of Vedavyasa in Vedagiri. It is believed that Pandavas visited Vyasa at Vedadri and got advised during their Vanavasa exile period. The remains of the ashrama is still there in the Vedagiri hill. Great works of Vedavyasa. Without Vedavyasa, there is no Indian language. And also not Vyasa. Vyasa and Valmiki played a vital role, important role in the field of language, religion, society, etc., etc. That's why these are the fathers of Indian literature. Vedas are derived from the root with knowledge to know. Hence the Vedas are the embodiments of knowledge. But Veda speaks about the narratives which makes the society to be elevated the higher level. Vedas are considered to be highest pramana as they are known to the world faultless because they are occurred by not of human beings origin but of divine origin. That is why we are called Vedas are not written by anyone, any human, and also that is called apaurushayas. And also we call Veda Pramana is the highest Pramana in Indian literature. Vedas are apaurushayas and also very divine literature. Vedavyasa divided the Vedas into four parts. Rigveda, Samaveda, Yajurveda and Atharvana Veda. He divided Vedas according to the subject, according to the narrations, according to the stories, according to the circumstances. He divided Vedas into the four parts. These are the four Vedas. That's why he divided that. That's why he is called Vedavyasa. These Vedas, however, are very difficult to understand. So, Vedavyasa mercifully made the teachings more simplified by writing the Puranas. The Puranas are condensed form of explanations of Vedas. Without the Puranas, most people would not be able to understand these teachings. Puranas and also epics are the essences of Vedas. That's why in Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita plays this very important role in the society. In Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says that Mahabharata and Bhagavad Gita is the essence of Indian literature, essence of Indian Vedas. Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Upanishatsu Brahma Vijayam Yoga Shastre Krishna Arjuna Samvade. That is the quote by Lord Krishna through the Vedavyasa Maharshi. Vyasa is the great poet and visionary who not only completed four Vedas and 18 Puranas but also wrote the Brahma Sutras, a monumental summary of all Vedic texts. The Brahma Sutra means it is the supreme efforts, supreme efforts. This plays a very important role in the Indian philosophy. All Indian philosophers are commented the Brahma Sutras in their own forms. And also, so many commentaries came from the Brahma Sutras. The Brahma Sutra also one of the Prasthanatraya texts in Indian three principal canons, it is called. He then made the Puranas especially easy to understand by writing the Mahabharata. Vedavyasa, the author of Mahabharata, by this, those who usually do not understand can comprehend the teachings easily. These Vedic texts were created for all to read and understand. This superhuman feat gives him a status of divine incarnation, and he is indeed listed as one of the seven Chiranjeevas. Already I told who are the Chiranjeevas, who are the Bhaktas, who lives always in this human world. These are called Chiranjeevas, Prahlada, Narada. Already I have quoted this sloka in the previous. Are immortal of Indian tradition, and this is indeed true in the sense that he lives so vividly today even after 5,000 years in the lives the millions of India. Vyasa is traditionally known as author of this epic. He also featured an important character in it. It indicates that as Valmiki is the contemporary of Sri Rama, as Valmiki and Rama joined in so many places and talked so many events like that, Vyasa also contemporary to the Kurukshetra war and also contemporary to the Sri Krishna, who is the incarnation of Lord Vishnu, because Vyasa is contemporary to the period of Mahabharata, Mahabharata war. He features as important character in it. He makes occasional appearance in the story as a spiritual guide, the young princess. In the first book of Mahabharata, why I am called this first book is Bruhatvat Bharatvat Mahabharata Machyate. Mahabharata is not compiled in the one side. First it is called Jayakya Samhita, next Bharata, next Mahabharata. Jayakya Samhita, originally Vyasa Maharshi wrote the Jayakya Samhita. In this first verse itself, he quoted the Jayakya Samhita means it is the victory between Kaurava and Pandavas. Jaya means the victory. Narayanam Namaskritya, Naram Chaiva Narottamam, Devim Saraswatim Chaiva, Tato Jayamudhirayet. That is the first verse from the Mahabharata. It is called the Vyadavyasa asked Ganesha to aid him in the writing the text. However, Ganesha imposed a condition that he would do so only if Vyasa narrated the story without flaws. It is a mythological story. Ganesha, who wrote the Mahabharata while Vyasa telling. It is a mythological story and also important divine story in Indian literature. To which Vyasa then made a counter condition that Ganesha must understand the verse before he transcribed it. In the Mahabharata, Vyasa appears from the fiction time as the author of and an important character in the Mahabharata. Glory of Mahabharata. The glory of Mahabharata indicates the we called Mahabharata as Panchama Veda. Panchama Veda means Vedas are Apurushayas and Elsa. Divine creatures. So it is not possible to understand Vedas by Vedas only. Only through Mahabharata and Puranas we can understand the Vedas. So Vyasa Maharshi wrote to understand the Vedas in a simple form. He wrote the Mahabharata. That's why we called Mahabharata as Panchama Veda. धर्मे चार्थे च कामे च मोक्षे च भरतर्षभ यदि हास्ति तदन्यत्र यन्ने हास्ति ततत्क्वचित्. Mahabharata is a great epic heroic poem. It contains 1 lakh verses. It contains the essence of all scriptures. 1 lakh verses means now Jayakya Samhita, Bharata, Mahabharata. In Mahabharata, so many akhyanas, so many moral episodes, so many Gitas like Bhagavad Gita and also Vishnu Sahasranama occurs from the Mahabharata itself. So Mahabharata becomes the voluminous verse. So it is called Mahabharata. Brahatvat Bharatvat Mahabharata Muchyate. If you cannot find anything here, you cannot find it anywhere else. That's why there is one proverb in the India. Yanna Bharate, Tanna Bharate. That is the important proverb to the Mahabharata greatness. Though Krishna Dvaipayana Vyasa is the author is to debate that it was a work of several contributors. It is considered along with the original Vyasa, his disciples and many other people spanning a few generations like Bharata, the Gautamas and the Kanvas. Evolution of Mahabharata epic. Mahabharata epic is events of war with the text of 1 lakh verses. The epic itself claims to have been originally just 8,800 verses. It is called 8,800 verses. It is called Jayakya Samhita. Composed by Krishna Dvaipayana Vyasa and called the Jaya. Later it became 24,000 verses called Bharata. Where, as already I told, how it became the Mahabharata, Jaya, Bharata, Mahabharata, when it was recited by the Vaishampayana. Finally, it was recited as the 1 lakh verses epic, the Mahabharata, by Ugrasravas, the son of Lomaharshana. Jaya, Dhritarashtra Sanjaya Samvada is called Jaya. The name Jaya meant victory in the Sanskrit. From Mahabharata itself, it is made evident that Vyasa created the seed of this epic and called it Jaya, containing a few 8,800 verse. As already I told about the Jaya, what is Jaya? Jayakya Samhita, importance of Jaya. Only Jayakya Samhita is composed by Vyasa Maharshi. Later, so many people developed the Mahabharata. From Mahabharata itself, it made evident that Vyasa created the seed of this epic and called it is Jaya, containing a few 8,800 verses. It was structured as a dialogue between the Kuru king Dhritarashtra and his companion and minister Sanjaya. Sanjaya, in this dialogue, narrates the Kurukshetra war as it happened. The battlefield of Kurukshetra between Dhritarashtra's son the Kauravas and Pandu's sons and Pandavas. Bharata Janamejaya Vaisampayana Samvada. It is dialogue between Janamejaya and Vaisampayana. From 8,000 Jaya, it grew into the 24,000 verses and began to be called Bharata. This was structured as a dialogue between Vyasa disciple Vaisampayana and Kuru king Janamejaya. It is a story of four generations: Dhritarashtra, Pandu, Arjuna, Abhimanya, Parikshit and Janamejaya. Not only Mahabharata indicates as the only epic stories and also dynastic stories and also dynastic history also indicates in the Purana. It is Mahabharata also like Puranas. As Purana, there are some characters, Sargascha, Pratisargascha, Vamsho, Manvantaranicha, Vamshanu, Charitam Cheva, Puranam, Panchalakshanam. So as Purana indicates, in Mahabharata also, Vyasa clearly follows the systems of Puranas in the Mahabharata also. This is clear that four generations of contributions added their contribution to the epic when it became the structured days. One can find that the original dialogue between Sanjaya and Dhritarashtra is embedded inside. Thus, Jaya is embedded within Bharata. The name Bharata means the history of the kings in the line of the great king Bharata. Mahabharata Saunaka Sauti Samvada, the grand epic takes the shape of dialogue between Vagrasrava Sauti and Sage Saunaka. The epic evolved into 1 lakh verses referred to the Mahabharata. The next stage, there are more than 1 lakh verses in the epic Mahabharata, meant that a great history of kings in the lineage of the great kings Bharata. Learning from this, the verse of Mahabharata, it is possible that the Vyasa who insected Ugrasava Srauti could be a sage in the lineage of Vyasa who authored the Jaya. Thus, Bharata is embedded in Mahabharata. Currently, we get to read this epic as the narration of dialogue between Ugrasava Srauti and Saunaka in the third person. Evolution of Mahabharata epic. It contains 18 parvas or sections. All everybody knows in India the Mahabharata contains the Mahabharata war happens 18 days, Mahabharata text 18 chapters, Bhagavad Gita text 18 chapters. That is the importance in the Mahabharata also. The text begins with the Adiparva, Sabhaparva, Vanaparva and finally with the end of Swargarohana it ends. Vyasa taught this epic to his son Sukha and his disciple Vaisampayana and others. King Janamejaya, son of Parikshit, the grandson of heroes of the epic, performed a great sacrifice. The epic was recited by Vaisampayana to Janamejaya at the command of Vyasa. Later on, Suta recited the Mahabharata as was done to Saunaka and others during the sacrifice performed by the Saunaka in Naimisharanya. The message from Mahabharata. Mahabharata itself is a message. It is the text of ethics, text of morals, text of histories, text of everything what not. But so it is called Panchama Veda. Hardship in life leads to the success. In Mahabharata, we will find many Pandavas and Draupadi, Nala and Damayanti, Savitri and Satyavan suffered the hardship in life. It is the means though which man is molded, disciplined and strengthened. It is just like how impure gold under the fire becomes the pure gold. Imperfect, weak man is rendered pure, perfect and strong by being melted in the crucial of pain and suffers. That's why in Bhagavad Gita he told, everybody must the sthitapragna. Sitoshna Sukadukeshu Samasanga Vivarjitaha Tulyaninda Stutirmoni Santusto Yenakena Chiti. That is the teaching of Mahabharata. One should not be afraid of pain and sufferings. They are blessings in disguise. They are eye-openers. They are silent teachers. They turn the mind towards God and instill mercy in the heart, strengthen the will and develop patience and power and endurance, which are the prerequisites for the God realization. Always talk truth and righteousness path. Mahabharata advocates the message of truth and righteousness. In Mahabharata, there is one Dharmo Rakshati Rakshitaha. those who protect the dharma, dharma will protect you. That is the principle concept of Mahabharata. The great epic produces a moral awakening in the readers of exhorts them to tread the path of satya and dharma. It urges them strongly to do good deeds, practice dharma, cultivate dispassion by realizing the illusionary nature of this universe and its vigorous and sensual pleasures, and attain eternal bliss and immortality. It induces people to do what Yudhishthira did and abandon the Duryodhana did. Stick to dharma tenaciously. You will attain everlasting happiness and dharma moksha, the summum bonum of life. This is the final purpose and central things of Mahabharata. A glory to Sri Bhagavan Vyasa, the grandsire of heroes, the author of Mahabharata, who is a Chiranjeevi and an incarnation of Lord Sri Vishnu. The teachings of this illusion epic guides the readers in every walk of their life. The reader influences to stick to dharma. The great characters of Mahabharata inspires each and everyone. The epic will generally contribute to imbibe the following to the follower of Mahabharata: the righteousness of Yudhishthira, the purity of Bhishma, the courage of Arjuna, the liberty of Karna. And also, you see, in Mahabharata contains the so many Gitas, so many important and also religious teachings are there. Now, we see in the present world, Bhagavad Gita plays a very important role. And also, Bhagavad Gita will always renders in everywhere. Like Bhagavad Gita, in Mahabharata, there are so many stotras, Kunti Stotra. And also, you see, in every temple, in every village, in every house, every day, we recite the Vishnu Sahasranama. This Vishnu Sahasranama also from the Mahabharata only. And also, for us, Bhishma gives the message: what is moksha, what is purity, what is sincerity, what is daya, what is kshama, how to behave with others, what is rajadharma, what is kshatriya dharma, how to collect the taxes from the people, also very nicely, very generally indicated in the Mahabharata. That's why Mahabharata is the text of encyclopedia of Indian literature. Thank you.